Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Zell Visiting Writer Series Reading and Q&A with fiction author Torrey Peters. My name is Michaela Coatsiers, and I'm your coordinator and host for the year. As for just a bit about our programming and what we do, the Helen Zell Writers Program brings 12 acclaimed authors to the University of Michigan each year to meet with our students and give public readings, craft talks, and Q&As. And the series is generously funded by Helen Zell and Janie Lack. And this week, we are very fortunate to have Torrey Peters visiting us on campus and reading for us tonight. We have a really nice turnout, so thank you all for coming. I'll just give a few administrative announcements, and then we'll keep moving towards the reading. So the first is to note that this event is recorded and posted on the Zell Visiting Writer Series YouTube channel, so you can rewatch or share with a friend later on if you'd like. And if you're joining us on Zoom, closed captioning is enabled, and you can turn that on or off by clicking the CC icon at the bottom of your Zoom screen. And Jen probably has already also posted a copy of Torrey's reading in the chat. And then for the structure of tonight's event, in just a minute, MFA student Josh Olivier will be introducing Torrey. After that, Torrey will give a reading for about 20 minutes. Around 6 p.m., another MFA student, Marnie Litfin, will have a 20-minute conversation with Torrey. And for the last 10 minutes, we'll open it up to audience questions. So if you're here in person, you can line up at mics on either side of the stage to ask your questions. Or if you need someone to walk a mic to you, just signal to Marnie on stage and I will walk a mic to you. And if you're on Zoom, you can post your questions in the chat and Jen will read them aloud on your behalf. And now I will hand it over for Torrey's introduction.
Torrey Peters is the author of three novellas, The Masquer, Infect Your Friends and Loved Ones, and Glamour Boutique. Her debut novel, Detransition Baby, won the 2021 Penn Hemingway Award for Debut Fiction, and was also a finalist for the National Books Critics Circle Award and the Brooklyn Public Library Award. Detransition Baby was longlisted for the Woman's Prize for Fiction, and Peters is the first openly trans woman to be nominated for this award. A collection of four novellas, Infect Your Friends and Loved Ones, will be published by Random House in 2023. Peters holds an MFA from the University of Iowa and a master's in comparative literature from Dartmouth. She is also, perhaps most importantly, a proud rider of a pink motorcycle. I remember first hearing about Detransition Baby. I remember finding the title savvy, snappy, badass. I'd been in a reading slump, buying and reading most of the buzzy contemporary novels that year, finding lots to admire, but little I really loved. Every time I went on the internet, there was a friend posting their advanced copy of Detransition Baby, marveling about its magnetic power. I bought Detransition on pub day. I brought it with me to work, to the bar. I finished the novel and found myself missing its characters, wondering how they were doing in their lives off the page. Peter's work allows us to glimpse the labyrinthine identity politics of queer Brooklyn. She writes on identity's nuanced relationship with culture, with selfhood. She writes about womanhood, trans womanhood, yes, and also the intersectional relationship between cis and trans women. Reading Torrey Peters, I'm drawn now, as I have always been, to how she so seamlessly welcomes her reader into the superabundant activity of her character's psychologies. I admire how Peters lets her characters think, fuck up, be wrong, the ways her characters hurt and love each other, and how we watch them fumble to love themselves. Peters has a rare gift, the ability to place human characters with all their contradictions and confusion and folly onto the page without condescending to them. When we laugh at her characters, we are laughing at ourselves, our own convoluted motivations, our own struggles to define, reach for, and hold on to whatever it is we think we want from the world. So lucky and proud to be introducing Torrey Peters. Here she comes. Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much for that really lovely introduction. I'm gonna just be reading from Detransition Baby tonight. I thought about, it's really right in my, I can't see anyone. It's like, I'm gonna be reading from Detransition Baby tonight. You don't really need to know anything about this, except to say that I chose two sections that are sort of about trans motherhood, which is one of the, and like the various ways that trans women can be mothers beyond sort of biological motherhood. I hope the two sections resonate. All right, here we go. I'm gonna grab that water. I sort of like this. It's like I'm alone, just like reading alone in my room. Okay. On a last minute whim, Reese decided to go see her friend Talia's weekly set at Dynamite, one of several North Brooklyn queer dive bars run by the same shady family of straight people. Talia was a former drag queen turned transsexual, one of the earliest converts in the great drag enlightenment, when a significant quorum of Brooklyn's queens came out as trans, began to inject estrogen, and renounced their gay past, the consequences of which miffed them into misandry, as the desperately cute twinks who used to sleep with them no longer would. Talia runs a set called Anger Management, in which she plays tropical dubstep to keep everyone chill, then undercuts her chill vibes with hourly advice sessions in which she solicits Ann Landers-style questions from the various twinks who form her now sexually unavailable fan base, then berates them for their stupidity in profound and profane harangues. It was reliably one of the most entertaining ways for Reese to spend a Tuesday night. Tonight, one of the twinks asks about sharing chores in a relationship. The twink has found in that in his relationship with a masked dom, he is doing much more household work. So can he employ feminist arguments for a more equitable share in the domestic labor? To which Tali responds that no, he is a little bitch. And in the midst of a shortage of actual true to God dom tops, he had best start scrubbing if he wants to keep his man happy. However, Talia adds, the whole premise of the question ought to be rejected because there's no such thing as a pure mask top. Everyone will eventually want something in their butt because that is the nature of having a butt. When the moment comes that things get equitable in bed, so should they be in domestic labor. The twinks giggle happily, but Talia rebukes them and demands that they give her quarters for her own laundry because her parents have cut off her money as a consequence for yelling at them on the phone. For emphasis, she shakes her tip bucket from the pedestal / DJ booth from which she reigns, then segues into one of her favorite themes, her parents. Her parents are good, long-suffering people, she tells the assembled twinks. And these good, long-suffering people still support her at age 29 because she is a spoiled brat who has never had a job. A weekly show at a queer bar doesn't count, which is an embarrassment to her. And what does she do to repay her parents for their generosity? She spits the words into the mic so acerbically that it pops with her consonants, then continues a second before answering her own question in mock outraged oration. She changed her gender just to stymie and confuse them. And now she yells at them on the phone and hangs up on them if they misgender her. That's what they get for supporting a child with artistic tendencies. But what did they expect? Did they think they could just let their child wear capri pants and there would be no consequences? And do you know the worst part, Talia demands of her twinks? The worst part is that most parents get to one day have a moment of comeuppance when their kids become parents, and then those kids reassess their own childhood with a parent's eyes and regretfully admit that dad knew best all along, and mommy was so generous and so kind and also beautiful and young. But not my parents, Talia concludes with a cackle, because with all the hormones, now I'm sterile. I stole that comeuppance from them. The cute boys in cutoff shorts lined up along the bar laugh. Talia theatrically narrows her eyes at them. What are you all laughing at? If you're here listening to me, she admonishes, it probably means you're also a disappointment to your parents. If you like my shtick and didn't just wander in off the streets, there's a high probability that you are also a degenerate who will never give your parents a grandchild. Talia spits out her gum in a peek, then continues on to the next question unabated. Talia had given Reese a drink ticket, and Reese laughs happily along with the rants, sipping on the free Corona. Reese sort of loves Talia's parents, or at least Talia's version of them. She empathizes with them. They make all the classic parents of a trans mistakes, but unlike Reese's own parents, they seem to truly and deeply love their child, as baffling and confusing as they find her. Reese can relate. Talia is deeply lovable and talented and spoiled and capable of inexplicable rage, which makes her one of the most compelling girls Reese knows. Talia also happens to be one of the most talented musicians in the city, though she prima donnishly refuses almost all offers to perform. Her parents' largesse allows her to avoid the grind of petty performances, which lesser musicians accept primarily in order to eat and secondarily to build up a following. Still, although Talia performs only rarely, half of her twink followers are fans of her music who settle for seeing her yell at them in a dive bar because it's the closest thing available to hearing her sing. Talia's talents only explain a part of Reese's deep affection for her. Reese knows a lot of talented people. Half the trans women in Brooklyn live in a state of perpetual pre-celebrity, awaiting a well-deserved recognition that will never come. No, more than simply finding Talia compelling, Reese secretly and proudly thinks of Talia as her trans daughter. Reese shares this with almost no one because she'd be mortified to take public credit for how remarkably level Talia has turned out to be, even though in her own mind, she deserves a healthy share of that credit. Reese met Talia in the first months of Talia's transition, just as Talia entered the full bloom of the second puberty, just as the changes in her body began to show, just as every evening the momentous pendulum of estrogenetic moods swung to despair, just as Talia burst into the period of transition when she cried at the moon and broke mirrors in self-loathing and fell in love, real and present love, for the first time. How many nights had Reese sat down with Talia to offer her counsel, both stern and loving, as Talia writhed like a turtle who'd lost its shell, its soft, unarmored flesh abraded by the newly felt humiliations of life as a transsexual? How many times had Reese gone over to Talia's apartment and held her when she cried and tried to give her advice without telling her how to act or patronizing her or creating a hierarchy in the friendship? Because as much as Reese wanted to shake Talia and tell her to grow the fuck up, she admired Talia and all the skills and dreams that she harbored, those same dreams and hopes that Reese herself had given up. Isn't that the most motherly thing of all? To hope your daughter has the chances that you never gave yourself or that you were never given? Mother-daughter relationships among drag queens or gay men have a long lineage as a New York City phenomenon, as every queer to have reverently watched Paris is Burning will gladly inform you. Reese knows the mother role still holds sway with the Black and Latina girls adjacent to the ballroom world, girls whose families reject them young and early, who need guidance and love and firm talking to's on occasion. That's not how it is with the white girls Reese knows, though. Those girls, unlike the teenagers seeking family in the ballroom scene, often haven't yet lost their sense of entitlement and won't stand to be told what to do, especially not from some tranny only slightly their elder whose own mistakes layer and squish on each other like a melting cake. Reese has raised a few trans daughters over the years, and all of the mothering has been tacit. The girls need it, yearn for it, but won't accept it if they realize what it is. And Reese, for as much as she complained about these ungrateful girls, needed them too, craved the chance to nurture someone, to care and soothe them with her softest, most selfless love. Talia sways slightly on her DJ pedestal, a little dance that both mocks and gives in to the cheesy chill of the vaporwave song she's just put on. All Reese's children, and here she is, still alone. How could Reese not feel kinship with Talia's parents? These nice middle-class people, he a doctor and she a teacher, who ache with worry for their daughter and who have no idea Reese exists, who can't know that there is a shadow mother plotting and worrying alongside them. She wants to hug Talia's parents, to tell them it will be okay. Suddenly, Reese has to get out of the bar. She has the awful fear that she might begin to cry. Pity from the early 20s trans girls among whom she sits would be the final mortification. Grabbing her purse, she slips out. No one notices. Behind her, Talia, charismatic as always, tosses back at the audience the slips of paper on which they've written their questions, then slides up the volume on another breezy dubstep mix in a show of huffiness that may or may not all be part of the act. On the sidewalk outside the bar, Reese attempts to bum a cigarette from a handsome guy who looks to her like a slightly femme Vin Diesel, but who doesn't register her until she speaks directly to him, because he's fixated on two slim boys leaning against each other in the doorway. Distracted, he gives her a cigarette, then coming to himself, chivalrously lights it for her. "That's my daughter in there," Reese tells femme Vin Diesel. He peers through the darkened glass windows at Talia, then back at Reese. "You must be very proud," he says gamely. The two slim boys move back inside, and femme Vin Diesel glances at them with an expression of loss, unsure how he has committed himself to playing a supporting part in some transsexual neurotic mother role play. "Go with your friends," Reese tells him. She angles a stream of smoke out the side of her mouth and waves a cigarette cherry in the direction where they've slipped away. He nods gratefully and steps lightly after them. A few moments later, Talia comes out. "Oh my God, I had to escape the baby transes in there. One of them was complaining how a cis woman looked at her today in the store. That's how wounded she is. She can't take being looked at. Two eyes appraising her is trauma. I can't take it." Such is the explosion of girls transitioning in and around the Brooklyn drag world. And so devoid are these girls of their own trans history that Talia, having been on hormones not quite 2 years, has found herself forcibly placed in a maternal role. Her tone evinces a teenage mother's exasperation with children, having just been one herself. Without asking, Talia takes a cigarette from between Reese's fingers and puffs hard. Reese laughs. "This is the moment." "What is the moment?" "The moment that you just said your mother would never get, when a daughter finally has kids of her own and begins to understand that her mother knew best all along." Talia exhales and hands a cigarette back to Reese, who declines it. "Don't be smug about it," Talia says. "Maternal smugness is very annoying. Remind me to tell that to my mother next time I call her." She lifts the sole of her shoe behind her, twists herself with easy balance to stub out the cigarette on it, and flicks the filter into the gutter. Her lashes curve luxuriously around her eyes, even when she doesn't wear mascara. And tonight, she's worn the mascara thickly, making the amber irises appear bright and unearthly by contrast, illuminated as they are by the orange light of the sodium vapor street lamps. Many people think a trans woman's deepest desire is to live in her true gender, but is actually to always stand in good lighting. Normally that means avoiding the unflattering orangey glare of streetlights. Yet Talia, with her dark curls and smooth skin, stands resplendent as a Creek pop star in the fiery hues. In Reese's memories of childhood, night had a different blue-black tone than in her adult life. And in fact, she later learned when she returned to visit Madison after a long hiatus, this change in the color of night was not an illusion of time and remembrance, but a historical fact. Like most American cities, Madison, Wisconsin had replaced the blue-white lighting of incandescent and mercury vapor street lamps with the orange of sodium vapor. This not only required less energy to run, but because a trick of the human eye perceives orange light to be brighter and thus more revealing than the same lumens of white-blue light, cities installed sodium vapor in the super predator panic 90s as a method to deter street crime, as though one would comfortably rape and murder and steal in the privacy of blue light, but would hew to a life of church-going and clean language if illuminated by the eerie public gaze of yellow-orange sodium vapor lamps. In the pictures of Reese's early childhood, cities shone as stars, but now they burned a combustion orange glow heavenward, flames licking the firmament as whole cities engulfed themselves in nocturnal conflagration, eternally incinerating, blazing, scorching everybody caught within their scaffolds of kindling. And at the center, her daughter, Talia, queen of fire. "I think I need my shot," Reese tells Talia. "I'm feeling very grandiose and morose and old. That's always a sign I'm hormonal. I was thinking that night is a different color than it used to be." "I have to change songs," Talia says, taking Reese lightly by the arms. "Stop being weird and come back inside." And this, Reese reflects, is the other reason to be a mother, in whatever fashion motherhood comes your way. So when you're old and alone and feeling sorry for yourself, your daughter will roll her eyes at your theatrics and bring you in from the cold. Thank you. Can someone tell me the time? How, sorry? 10 more minutes? Okay. All right. So this is a section, one of the characters in the book, Detransitions. And this is a little section where the story is, it's mostly about Reese, but the action kicks off with Ames, who used to be a trans woman named Amy, but detransitioned, gets his boss, Katrina, pregnant. And then to sort of like avoid fatherhood tries to put together, or like the idea of fatherhood is so repellent to him that he sort of tries to put together this unconventional family with his ex Reese. That's like the basic plot of the book. And here Katrina has found out that, you know, this, what she thought was a man who had gotten her pregnant used to be a transsexual, and she kind of freaked out, and now they're talking about it. Katrina peers at him, squinting a little in the sunlight. "Why did you detransition then?" He scoops up a handful of sand, feeling it run through his fingers. "Do you want the cold facts or the abstract reason?" "The cold facts." "Two things happened that were related. I convinced myself that I couldn't protect and satisfy the girl I loved, also a trans woman, while being trans myself. The other thing that happened was that I got beaten on the street and no one helped me. It was the last straw. Living as a trans woman just seemed too fucking hard after that." "In New York?" "Brooklyn, but not what it makes it sound like. It was a rich white guy who did it in Williamsburg. He wore khakis. His getaway car was an Audi SUV." Katrina gave him a once over as though looking for wounds or evidence, as if he were saying it had just happened. "So you got sick of being trans?" "I got sick of living as trans. I got to the point where I thought I didn't need to put up with the bullshit of gender in order to satisfy my sense of self. I am trans, but I don't need to do trans." Ames could run through this routine without even thinking about it. How many times had he tried to explain his detransition to other trans women, tried to assuage the sense of betrayal that their wariness obviously communicated? In Ames's formulation, trans women knew what trans women were. They knew how to be, but they didn't know how to do. All the intra-trans fights online, all the arguments with cis people, all of it was just to define what it means to be a trans woman, to say what she was. But when you're a trans woman, there's almost nothing out there on how to actually live. In his last year of living as a woman, the year in which Ames stopped being so angry with how cis people treated trans people, and he started growing sad and contemplative about how trans women treat each other, he came up with a private, not particularly catchy term for the trans women of his cohort, the ones who began transition in the early 2010s. He called them juvenile elephants. Nowadays, Ames didn't really feel like he had the right to say anything much about trans women, but if you had asked him that year, he would have told you about juvenile elephants. In 2002, park rangers in the Lulawe Imfolozi Game Reserve in South Africa hunted down and shot a gang of three juvenile elephants that had made a sport of chasing, raping, and killing rhinoceroses. The elephant gang raped and murdered 63 rhinos before the park rangers caught up with them. In Sierra Leone, another herd of elephants razed a village of 300, flattening the mud and wattle homes and killing an elderly woman who attempted to chase them away. A young elephant in that pack, barely full grown, pinned the woman to the ground with a knee and slowly gored his tusk through her chest with malicious precision. Towards the end of the civil war in northern Uganda, Karamojong villagers began to leave out poison-laced elephant snacks to retaliate against raids by the legally protected elephants of nearby Kidepo Park, who smashed the homes in the adjacent villages to get drunk on the fermenting fruit the Karamojong used to brew wine. Perhaps the villagers needn't have bothered. Since the mid-90s, 90% of male elephant deaths in South African game parks could be attributed to murder by other roving gangs of pachydermicidal elephants, a 1,500% increase in elephant-on-elephant violence over previous decades. Ames learned all this in an essay entitled Elephant Breakdown, published in the science journal Nature, in which a group of leading elephant behaviorists argued that the abnormal quality and frequency of elephant attacks and violence could no longer be understood through the long-standing reasoning that suggested high levels of testosterone in young males or competition for scant land and resources. No, the behaviorists argued, the younger generation of elephants suffered from a form of chronic stress, a species-wide trauma that has led to a total and ongoing breakdown of elephant culture. The cause is simple. Throughout their long history, elephants have lived in intricately ordered social structures. Young elephants learn their place and healthy behavior in concentric societal rings of caregivers, birth mother, aunts, grandmothers, friends, relationships that might last a lifetime, 70 years or more. Unless orphaned, Young elephants stay within 15 feet of their mothers for the first 8 years of their lives. When an elephant dies, her family members grieve and ritually mourn. The bereaved conduct week-long vigils by the body, covering it with brush and rubbing their trunks along the teeth of the lower jaw of the carcass, a gesture of greeting among live elephants. This millennial generation of elephants is an orphan generation. In the last few decades, humans have murdered, mutilated, or displaced an entire generation of older elephants who might have bestowed upon this generation the familial, societal, and emotional skills required to handle one's individual 15,000 pounds of muscle and bone, through which courses intolerable memories of pain, trauma, and grief. When the park rangers in South Africa finally caught and shot the three elephants responsible for the rhino assaults in the park, researchers examined the corpses and determined that all three perpetrators had been transported by wardens to the game reserve some years earlier. All three had been adolescent males, originally found as juveniles, chained to the bodies of their dead and dying relatives, a practice that poachers commonly employ so that the park rangers can find and handle the young ones, much as fishermen toss back young fish. Once transported to a new locale, a savanna free of any elders, the three traumatized elephants found each other, bonded in mutual sorrow and grief, and wreaked their vengeance upon each other and the world. Ames, having explained the condition of juvenile elephants, drew this metaphor. Trans women are juvenile elephants. We are much stronger and more powerful than we understand. We are 15,000 pounds of muscle and bone forged from rage and trauma, armed with ivory spears and faces unique in nature, living in grasslands where any of the ubiquitous humans may or may not be a poacher. With our strength, we can destroy each other with ease. But we are a lost generation. We have no elders, no stable groups, no one to teach us to countenance pain, no matriarchs to tell the young girls to knock it off or show off long lives lived happily and well. Those older generations of trans women died of HIV, poverty, suicide, repression, or disappeared to pathologize medicalization and stealth lives. And that's if they were lucky enough to be white. They left behind only scattered, exhausted voices to tell the angry, lost young when and how the pain might end, to tell us what will be lost when we lash out with our considerable strength or use the fragile shards of what remain of our social networks to ostracize, punish, and retaliate against those who behave in a traumatized manner. And so we become what we have seen. How could we know not to? Have you seen many orphan juvenile elephants behaving otherwise? Thank you.
Hi, Torrey. Thank you so much for that wonderful reading. I'm so glad you got the memo about the black jumpsuit.
It's good, yeah.
Thank you for reading that first section. I literally on my note cards wrote down the quote about a trans woman's greatest wishes to stand in good lighting, because it is my favorite line of the book. Because the narration in this book is so fun.
Thank you.
Yeah. The narration in this book is like one of the chief pleasures of reading it. Even on like the very first page, you really pull the reader. Like you tell people on the first page, look at Reese. There's like a lot of like grabbing. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I love this narrator. The narrator is like the narration in this book is like such a top.
That's true. Well, thank you.
And I wanted to ask, like, how did you develop the narrative voice and what did it look like as you revised? And like, did you ever have to rein it in?
Yeah. I mean, it's funny, the line that you just talked about, the like the standing in good lighting, there's like a few of those that were basically like, they started out where like I wrote them as tweets. And then I was like, I'm not giving this away. Like, and I was just like, I'm actually gonna, I had this like, I was also trying to like not do Twitter. And at that time, and I was like, I'm going to actually take everything that would be a tweet, put it in the book. And if it's still funny 3 years later, like when it's published, it'll go out. But there were a lot of things that were like, I realized, like, actually were just like topical to the moment, that like I would just sit in my room and like Talia's rant is a little bit also like my rant, you know, and I would just like rant alone into the computer.
Yeah.
And so a lot of it was like, which of these rants actually are like maybe literary, and which are just me ranting alone in my bedroom. And and luckily the nice thing about like writing a novel is that you have like you have a timeline enough that you can look back and be like, oh, that's just like a furious rant because someone said something to you one day. It's not like book buyers don't need to hear that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So that's my method, is rant at the computer.
Congratulations on not doing Twitter.
Thank you.
Yeah. I also wanted to ask you about the humor in the book, because you use humor in so many different ways. Like Reese can be very biting. Katrina like can like neg Ames in these ways that are really sweet. And then Ames will try to like undercut a really serious moment with like a really like wah-wah joke.
Yeah, that's right, Ames.
And I was wondering like what was the process of developing like the different like strains of humor in the book?
I mean, a lot of it is just comes out of the way I talk to my friends, you know? And there was like a sort of like two versions of like how the book happened with humor. The first, probably half of it when I first wrote it, which I just read from the first half, it wasn't that funny in the first draft. Like I've really felt a lot of these things, you know. Even that section about the elephants, I both like mean it and I also think it's like overwrought, and that it like Ames is wrong in some ways about this. Mm-hmm. But like letting myself get really overwrought as I wrote to sort of just like feel these things, and like what if this was true, and what if I just let myself believe this through this character, mm-hmm. in that sort of like letting it happen that way. And so there's like a kind of thing where like, and then about halfway through me writing it, which also corresponded to like basically half the time I was living in Brooklyn, mm-hmm. a lot of the stuff that like I really felt began to seem very funny to me, like gender. It's like for a while you're like gender, and then you're like, ha, gender, you know? And it's like, at some point, like, you know, the things that were hurtful to me, like, you know, you go to like, I don't know, like you go to like a Home Depot and.
Yeah, you do.
Yeah, definitely go to Home Depot. And like, you know, people act weird to you there.
Yeah.
And for a while you're like, this sucks. Like, I just want to go buy a screwdriver or whatever it is. I don't want to like have a gauntlet of gender performance at the Home Depot.
Yeah.
And then like after a couple of years, you're like, oh man, I'm going for the Home Depot gender gauntlet, you know? And you're like, this guy's gonna explain to me how a screwdriver works because I have long hair, you know? Like, yeah. And that it suddenly is like, it's like, it is both sad. Like, it's like, this is weird. And then it's also like, this is actually like hilarious and kind of a joy in life,
yeah.
In a weird way. I love the Home Depot now.
Oh yeah. No, in my house, we refer to going to Home Depot as going to summer camp, because you always learn something about yourself.
They're always wrong though. Like, it's like, how did you explain to me wrong how a screwdriver works? They just want to explain something to me.
Thank you.
Done with the Home Depot bit. But
yeah.
Oh, but I forgot to say that. I forgot to finish my thought. I got so caught up on Home Depot. The point is that about halfway through I changed it. And then I had to like go back and like weave sort of the perspective that I had come to through the writing process back into the beginning. That's what I meant to say.
So did you take like a period of time off while you were writing to like give yourself like the gift of distance on the drafts? Or was this just like... how did you like make room to let yourself have those epiphanies?
I mean, I think it's like very nice and intentional sounding to make it sound like, oh, I took space or took time off, but really I was just like living, and you know, things often get in the way of writing, mm-hmm. like, you know, breakups or jobs or not having jobs. Mm-hmm. And so there was like a kind of halfway point in the writing, where I basically was like, I don't know if this is going to ever get published. I don't know if anyone wants it. And I was in the middle of like a really bad breakup, and I took the fourth chapter, and that chapter, I published it as a novella called The Glamour Boutique, and I self-published it, by the way. Most of my writing previous to this was, I was very into this project of self-publishing and giving away for free on the internet novellas. And so I self-published that novella. And that was such like a sort of like difficult thing to do. And then I had the breakup right afterwards, and I was just like, I'm emotionally exhausted. So it's like nice to sort of think of it as like, oh, I took space and like came back to it. But really it was just sort of like life forced me to take space, and life forced me to start having a sense of humor, because it was just painful to not have a sense of humor.
Cool.
Yeah.
Thank you. So there are a ton of writers in the audience, and a number of us in the MFA program took a class last year on the art of revision. And the class ended up like being a space for us to all reveal like our secret like neuroses and demons and inner voices that say terrible things to us when we revise. And I was wondering if you might share a little bit about what your revision process looks like, besides like taking these chunks of time. And if you have any neuroses or demons when you revise that you might like to share.
Yeah, I mean, it's always so humiliating to look at your own writing, you know? It's like, and so there's like, there's a lot of it was for me that, again, I had an idea of that this book might travel as far as it did, but I wasn't sure of it. I wasn't, you know, I didn't have an advance. I didn't have like a book contract. I wrote it, you know, just kind of like, well, if worse comes to worse, I'll just self-publish, which is what I've already been doing, and things will just be status quo. But there was a sense a little bit that I was like airing dirty laundry a little bit. And a lot of my work was like emotional work with it, was learning how to basically be like, it's fine to share things that are shameful. It's fine that like, actually it's like very productive to pick up like something that's seems very shameful or that could hurt people. Like the Glamour Boutique section, if you haven't read the book, it's about Ames going to a cross-dressing store and like dressing up with this guy, and they're both clearly getting off on it. And this is, if you don't know trans history, that might not be like, whatever, they're getting off on dressing up. But if you do know trans history, it's like, it fits with this very transphobic trope of the idea that trans women aren't really women. They're just perverts who like to dress up like women. And essentially like this scene validates that transphobic thing. And basically I was trying to say that like, no, actually lots of people get off on their gender. And why exactly is it only dangerous for trans women to want, you know, to find sort of like sexual pleasure in experiencing their own gender? But I don't like say the gender theory quite that, you know, I just have to show off Ames kind of getting off on it. And so it's like, it was like, I knew that that was going to be responded to in bad faith, both in terms of like transphobes who read the book, and kind of like a respectability politics in terms of trans readers, who would be like, you're giving fuel to this like transphobic myth that we're all perverts. And so for me, a lot of the work was basically being like, no, I believe this. And I, you know, both are figuring out like, when does something have to cut because it's gratuitous? And when am I cutting something or revising something because I'm actually scared and don't want people to like say something mean about me or think that I'm like selling them out or giving fuel to bigotry. And so that tended to be like some of the hardest parts. And there's definitely like a version of it that's a little bit more raw. But I think that rawness is a little bit like the rants in my bedroom. Like they're me just being like, I don't care, I'm going to do it. And then slowly being like, actually, this is like me acting out rather than good art.
Cool.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So in some other interviews you've given, you've talked about like the challenge of writing around like the banality of transness and like the trans story, like having, you know, like the transition story has like beats to it. And like part of the challenge of this book was like writing around banality. And I was wondering if you could talk about what that looks like at a craft level.
Sure. I mean, this isn't totally mine. It's like, I came to the kind of writing I did through a scene in Brooklyn that was based around this press, Topside Press. And it was largely the ethos of it was trans women writing for other trans women. And this wasn't something either that we invented. This came from like, you know, a lot of actually like Black feminist writers. You know, the most easy sort of quote to pull out is Toni Morrison, who said she writes explicitly for other Black women. And what that means is that instead of like slowing down and doing like 70% story and 30% explanation, you can write at a full out sprint. And two, it raises the bar on what you can say. Like if I write about hormones to other trans women, they're gonna be like, yeah, hormones, I do them every week. This is incredibly boring. Like, tell me something new. And in fact, like the bar on saying something new about hormones is so incredibly high that I have never done it. I've never said anything original or smart or funny about hormones. And so it's less like a like avoiding the beats than just like, actually this is like, if I imagine that audience forces me to like elevate and forces me to question what is interesting or about the trans experience. And there's like, the funny thing is like, I appreciate you say that like, I avoided the banality of trans experience, but I think part of that was actually embracing the fact that the trans experience is very frequently banal. Like, and so then it's like, if I actually want to write about the trans experience, how do I write about the banality of it in a way that's honest or revealing? So the genre of this book in a lot of ways is melodrama. You know, it's like, it's a soap opera. It's like, I got her pregnant, but then I want a family. And then like, and it's like this. And in some ways it's like, this is just like people with their problems in a very banal way. And there's something almost like freeing about just being like, actually the trans experience is a very banal experience. When one looks at it a certain way, or at least in my version of it, I don't want to speak for all trans people, but my version of transsexuality is surprisingly banal. And in that banality, you get to then explore and say whatever you want. You get to actually find new things that other people haven't gotten to pull up because they've been very like, you know, reverent about it, or very pious about it, or very like, oh, we can't say this, or we can't say that, or we can't look at it in this way. And that, so like, there's like the old banality, and I want to reject the old banality, but I'm like embracing the new trans banality.
I love that.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. I don't want to spoil the ending for anyone, but I kind of do because I want to ask a question about it. Okay. No. Okay.
Then we can talk around it. I will say something. I'll just say, I don't think you can spoil this ending. Like, I wrote something so unspoilable. No, I don't think it's a spoilable.
Give me
ending.
A minute.
Yeah.
Okay. So the book ends where it ends. I'll say that for folks who know. And I was wondering if you knew that was the ending you were writing towards, like that moment in their timeline, like had you ever wanted to write further down the line in their relationship, or like have an epilogue, like, or were you like, this is where I need the story to end? And why did you choose that particular point in time, which I will not say anything else about?
Well, I'm gonna spoil it because I actually think it's unspoilable. It was just that the book begins with three people sitting in a room being like, can we make a family together? And sorry for this, but you're not actually losing anything. This is gonna help it. The book ends with three people in a room being like, should we have a baby together? And obviously like that sounds like the worst book in the world because like nothing has happened, right? They're like, you'd be like, well, they started in a room and they ended in a room. And for me, that's exactly right. Because the journey, I think for my generation of trans women isn't like to make a prescriptive decision. It's to like, the journey that they went on is one of like stripping away the kind of like lies, the narratives that they tell themselves, the coping mechanisms, the ways that we like delude ourselves. And so that the journey is, if you ask a question at the beginning of this, of the book, and you're asking it through like a fog of your own delusions, and then by the end, you ask that same question like with clarity, then you've really gone somewhere. And it's not necessarily like a thing where it's like, and then they went off into the sunset or whatever. It's like, you're actually at that place. And this for me is very important because that's what I feel like the answer to, for like my generation of like, how do you as a trans woman live? Like, how do you make a life? Because I do think that the situation for my generation of trans women is different than previous generations. The previous generations, the question was one oftentimes of survival, like the horizon of where you, not always, but frequently, it was like, how do you just make it? Like, you know, and for me, I have this, I mean, I've been exceptionally lucky in that I'm like up here talking about this stuff, but at times in my life, it wasn't that way. And a lot of times it would be like, I'd have a horizon of the future, I'd be like, that was still further than that previous generation. And it was like, how do I actually live? And how do I frame the questions that will like allow myself to live that, to make a successful life? And so the book for me is not like that you get to the end and you're like, I too should get my boss pregnant and make like a family and like, and that's the way to live. Like, so that's why it's unspoilable, because you shouldn't do these things that these characters have done, but you should, like, in the end, what they're doing is they're just finally honest with each other. And what is illustrative is the journey to honesty that I want for myself, that I want for my friends, you know, that I'm asking myself, how do I live? And the questions that I brought in to answer that question are from like all over the place. Like, they're from cis women, they're from gay men, they're from other trans women, they're from, you know, trans elders. Like, Ames is wrong, there are trans elders out there. And that framing of how is one honest so that when one can actually like accept the consequences of one's decision, is for me the ending. And the to like be like, and then they had the baby, that's just kind of prescriptive at that point, rather than the work that I was actually trying to do, both for my reader and for myself, that I was like, I want to know how to live.
Did you realize that was your project when you started this book?
Yeah, I mean, I think for me, oftentimes fiction is like a urgent and burning question for me. Mm-hmm. Like, all of my books in the last, or all of my writing projects in the last like, I don't know, 7 years have usually been something that bothers me, that like fiction is a way to like sort of like do a test case or a hypothesis, like where it's like, on one hand, it's like, I feel like the radical queer thing to do is to like reject family. And yet I grew up with like all of these messages about family. And I know that in a lot of ways, like these radical ideas don't necessarily make me happy. Like, on one hand, feminism, on the other hand, like the ways that these guys treat me make me happy. How do I reconcile these various opposing things? And, you know, one way is to like obviously go and do the things that these characters do, but the other way is to just write them and like explore it and figure out this stuff. You know, to me, part of it's like a solitary process, alone figuring the stuff out, but also the process of writing is oftentimes a process of conversation with other people to like bring in all of these perspectives so that at some point I don't actually have to do this work. You know, the one of the novellas that I wrote was about shame, about fetishes, about like the sort of unspeakable side of fetishes that involve trans stuff and like where the borders of transness are. And that bothered me. It bothered me, like, you know, the book involves a female masker, which is like somebody who dresses up in like a full body silicone suit that's like a woman suit. And the question is like, is this person trans? You know, and not to just be like, I reject this person because they look like a perv to me, but to basically be like, where is this border? Like, is that actually what I'm doing? And to like play it out in fiction. That stuff to me feels very urgent.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Sure.
Should we wrap it up? Can I ask one more question? Oh, okay. Then I will wrap it up. If anyone has a question they'd like to ask Torrey, there are mics on either side of the room. And I can't see anyone, but if you need a mic brought to you, give a little whistle or a shout out and someone will bring you a microphone. Do we have any audience questions? I can. Hi.
Hi. First of all, I just wanted to say I'm a really big fan. I think this is probably one of the best books that I've read that has come out in like the past, like since COVID, basically. Like,
I don't, thank you.
And I just wanted to, I think one of the things that was so remarkable about this book was the characterization. I just wanted to know how you envisioned your characters, how you came up with them. Like, was it from personal experience? And I guess, how did you make them feel so real?
Well, thank you for feeling that. It was like a slow, it's like a slow process of like discovering my characters. Like, I wish I just could like invent the characters and have them, but I sort of like have to find them. So Reese, is like sort of like the bitchy side of me, like the catty bitchy side. And I used to do this thing where like when I went on, I love that this is recorded. When I would go on Grindr, and when I was like seeing guys on Grindr, I didn't know if it was like worth it for them to come over. So I used to make them buy me sushi before they'd come over. And it was like a hurdle. It was like, do you really, like, I, of course it's like, do you want to sleep with me? They would be like, yes, I do. And I was like, well, I can't believe you. I can't believe like that you really like me. But it was like, do you like me enough to like go pick up, take out sushi for me? And if they did, I would be like, why don't you come on over? You really like me, you know? And so, and there was like this, like, so I wrote this, it like Reese kind of happened, is that I was writing this character who was doing the Grindr sushi thing. And that voice, the Grindr sushi voice, let's call it, was just like ready made. And it was sort of like a question of like leaning into that voice. And then with Reese, who's, there's three characters, but I only do free and direct style for two, which I involved a whole lot of choices. There was a time when I wrote Katrina in a free and direct style, but for lots of reasons having to do like the technical way that the book fit together, I ended up cutting it. But for Ames, I had a really hard time finding his voice originally because he's dissociated. And so like so much of fiction is about wanting things, and Ames is dissociated. He doesn't know what he wants. And what happened for me is I had a friend who was getting a trans surgery, and this is right before, this was before the Obamacare, whatever, covered this in New York. So a lot of the trans girls I knew would go to Mexico and to Guadalajara to get surgery. And we would like take care of each other at the, there was like a place where you'd stay after you had surgery. So my friend was getting surgery and I went down to take care of her. And my passport had not yet been changed to the M to the F marker. And I was just like, I don't really want to deal with customs, like explaining this. And I had this suit, this like Reservoir Dog style suit in my closet. It was like a skeezy suit with like a skinny black tie and like white shirt. And I was just like, I'll wear that down. And kind of like an androgynous Reservoir Dog style. And I got through customs, no problem. It was great. And then the airline was like, yeah, we lost your luggage. And so then I just only had this suit in Guadalajara. And like, that would have been fine anyway, but I was also like at a trans clinic, you know, where like, it's like a lot of trans people being like, wow, this one's so confused, you know, like, so I was like wandering around, and then my friend was like, you know, like she was out of it the entire time. So I just had like 2 weeks to spend. Eventually my clothes arrived, but like I had 2 weeks to spend sort of wandering around in this Reservoir Dogs days. And I would just like walk into like, I don't know what they're called, the equivalent of like bodegas, and I'd like mutter things and like just, I don't know. I felt great, honestly. I felt like super powerful, like that the people didn't know what to make of me. And this whole experience of traveling as a woman that had been like stressful before suddenly went away. And I was like this, I wouldn't say I was an intimidating figure, but I was like a confusing figure, which is similar to intimidating. And so I was like, I loved it. I loved it. And the more I kind of like leaned into it because I liked it, the more also kind of like strangely dissociated I got, where I was like playing a role and I was like watching myself behave. And I came back to Brooklyn after that. And I just like started writing as though I was still in the suit, essentially. And that voice is Ames's voice. So I don't know if that's like a good craft technique, like go to Mexico, wear a suit, wander around in a daze. But I do think that there's a way in which like there's a kind of serendipity to finding your character's voices that feels real, not because that's who I am, but because I went through a world in which that was a possibility.
Thank you. I think we have a question over there.
Yeah. First off, I fucking loved your book. It was amazing. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm wondering, so obviously you've written historically for a trans audience in this book as well. What has it been like for it to kind of become a little bit mainstream and to have some cis and straight readers?
Well, historically, I did write for, thank you for that question, by the way. Historically, I did write for a trans audience, and that's sort of how I found a lot of my ethos and my way of approaching it. But for various reasons having to do with like the scene I was in, which kind of fell apart, I also discovered writing books for trans audience that like not all trans people like my books, you know, like I wish it was the case, but it's not. And so writing along the lines, I mean, I talk about writing for trans audience and it's really a shorthand. It's like it's an easy shorthand, but I don't actually write for all of the trans audience. A lot of trans people don't like my books. A lot of them don't see my way of doing things. And so there was a way in which I began to replace the word identity with affinity, that I was like, I'm writing for people who have an affinity with me. And I thought of them as like a portion of the trans, you know, readership. But eventually I was like, at the same time that I was like asking these questions about how to live, I realized I was reading a lot of books by cis women, especially, I mean, the book is dedicated to divorced cis women. And that too is like a real shorthand. It's not like really for divorced cis women. But it was like divorced cis women seem to be facing the same problems that I was facing. They, you know, how do you start over in the middle of your life without getting bitter or, you know, living in a fantasy about what you're doing? And so I was reading like, you know, Rachel Kosker. I was reading, you know, I really had this like period where I was big on Ferrante, and they were asking these questions. And I was like, oh, I have an affinity with these books. And I don't have an affinity in the way that they think I have an affinity. I have this other affinity. And they're teaching me how to live. But yet I also think that like their version of gender is like, it's fine, but it's like missing a piece. So I want to talk back. And I began, and so the idea that there is a contradiction between a certain cis audience and a trans audience, I basically don't believe. I believe that there's like an affinity group that I'm aiming at. And that affinity group includes a large portion of cis women. So when I went, you know, I didn't know it was going to be on a big publisher, but when I went to the big publisher and they didn't understand that it was a trans iteration of like a certain kind of women's literature, it was really important to me to basically be like, no, you don't understand. This book was written this way. It was written to be read by readers of Ferrante, because or at least some of them, because actually we're in conversation and I'm talking back to them. And there isn't, there's no line, sharp line of demarcation between my trans readers and my cis readers when they're grouped together by a certain kind of affinity. And the work of that isn't a work necessarily of like a political, like, you know, I don't know, taxonomy, as it is a kind of like feeling of being recognized in address. And I don't think there's any contradiction between trans women feeling addressed and cis women feeling addressed in that way. Thank you for that question.
We have time for one more question. And I think I see someone over there.
Yeah. Hi, yeah, thanks so much for being here. It's a huge highlight of like my year that you're here talking about this book.
Thank you.
This book was very like, it was a very touching book for me and also just a fun one to be sharing with friends. Specifically, I was really excited that you read the juvenile elephants passage, because when I read this passage for the first time, I literally FaceTimed a friend in the middle of the night and was like, I have to read this out loud to you. And so hearing that over was really great. But I have a question specifically about that passage. So it's a larger narrative by, you know, using this passage as an analogy to like family structures and motherhood. I'm just curious where the juvenile elephants came from. Did you like, how did you come across that? Because it was something that I was just like, the connection was really interesting to me. I'm curious if, like, that came first, or if you knew you wanted to tell this story and kind of incorporated it.
Well, so I didn't like, I wasn't the one first one to recognize that sort of thing as like a poignant thing. It was actually in a 2006 article in Nature that I read, because people had been like, well, this is crazy, you know, this is a very interesting art thing. And it was passed around in like 2006. And a lot of people were like, oh, this is child soldiers, or this is various things. And what was interesting to me isn't so much like, is this a perfect allegory or a perfect metaphor or something? What's interesting to me is what it says about the process of making yourself understood. So basically, if you think about it, it's like a double thing where you say basically like, these humans are like elephants who are like humans. And then people are like, oh, they're humans. They're human after all, you know? And the question for me is like, why do you have to go through this, like this ecotone of elephants? Why do you have to go through like elephant trauma to basically believe like, oh, child soldiers are traumatized, or like trans women, they're traumatized after all. You know, there's a kind of thing where like, there's actually, for me, when I wrote it, I've gone through so many things with this allegory. It's meant a whole lot of things for me. And it's probably like the most, one of the more controversial parts of the book. There's people who definitely find it problematic in all sorts of ways. But like, there was a part of me that just like wanted to put it on the page and let it sit there with all of its, like, you know, like, let it, like, why should a character have a perfect analysis? Why should a character have this thing? There's something going on here that's both like very sad about the elephants, and also very sad that in order to understand trans women, we need to see them as elephants. And all of it's messy, all of it's inchoate, and that messiness is actually like what makes I feel like that part alive. And so I left it in there as, I mean, I framed it a little, like in my revision, for instance, I like framed that, I really just left it as like, the first time I wrote it, like, do with this as you will. And then I realized that people weren't really reading it the way I wanted them to read it. They weren't seeing it as a sort of like, just like a little bomb that I threw in the text. And so I like framed it a little bit with Katrina at the end. But to be totally honest, like, the problem with writing about only three characters is you only have three characters to like contextualize stuff. And there's a way in which Katrina is not the perfect person to contextualize that quote, but Reese isn't in the room yet. And that was like, that was just how I solved the problem. And so I actually like, I had Katrina question it, but I couldn't really have her question it too much
And it was just a technical plot problem of like, what do you do when you only have two characters in a room and you need someone to question what one of the characters says for the overall thematics of the book, you know? And I was like, this is good enough, you know, which is a lot of my solutions to things. But in the end, I was like, I can cut this and simply not have this technical problem, or I can just let it sit there and be uncomfortable for in a myriad of different ways, in the ways that it is for me, where I really like it. I don't necessarily think it's right, but I don't want to get rid of it either. And you know, I want other people to read it, and I want them to like figure out, like think their way through it. And that's, so I appreciate you asking that question because it gives me some time to actually, I did choose it to read to, and without the context of the rest of the book, to basically be like, here's what I'm doing with it. So thank you so much for that.
Thank you. I think that concludes our Q&A. Yes. Folks, give it up for Torrey Peters.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you for amazing questions.
I believe you, Literati is selling books upstairs and you'll be signing them.
I also believe that.
There, yeah, great. So if you would like to buy a book and have Torrey sign it, you can go upstairs right now. Thank you so much for coming, everyone. Oh, wait, Michaela is gonna, okay, great, your turn.
You can go up in just 2 seconds. I have some other closing announcements. But first, thank you again, Torrey, for such an amazing reading and really engaged Q&A. And thank you, Marnie, for facilitating it. Thank you, Josh, for your introduction. Thank you, Jen, for co-hosting on Zoom. Quick plug that Torrey will be giving a craft lecture tomorrow morning from 10 to 11 titled Household Gods and Hobgoblins of the Little Mind, Questions of Audience, Both Real and Imagined. Everyone's welcome to join in person. That's in Angel Hall 3222, or you can join via Zoom, again, using the same link that you used for tonight's event. And if you'd like to receive notifications about our events in the future, you can sign up for our email list, either using the link that Jen will drop in the chat on Zoom, or there's a sign up sheet right outside the door. And again, yes, please visit the book table too to buy books from Literati and have Torrey sign a copy. And otherwise, thank you again for coming out and have a great rest of your evening.